It's a great honor to be here for the fifth installment, the penultimate installment of the Letters Flying Free. Oh my gosh, the Rebbetzin is here. Did I see the Rebbetzin over there? I just scanned it. Oh, now I'm in trouble. She is going to tell her father about this. I'm really nervous now. We'll start all over again. Okay. We're in the penultimate meeting of the Letters Flying Free. I sent out an email, if you're on my constant contact list, to get a survey of what people thought of this series and the series we gave in Brooklyn to get a sense of how we can improve, because God willing, we will move forward with this. There seems to be a certain groundswell of enthusiasm for this, for these subjects, but we want to do it wisely and in a way that meets the needs of our viewing audience, both live and on the internet. Rabbi Teitelbaum has prepared an absolutely fantastic shiur for the second half of this hour. So I'm going to speak really quickly to give him maximum time, because he's really going to take us deep into the ideas of the Ibn Ezra in text, and I think it's going to be quite fascinating. I'm actually recycling a class that I gave about 2 years ago, which was sponsored by the Hermes, which, and I believe they're members of this shul, so it's ironic that we get to reuse their original sponsorship when I was in Bell Harbor. Our topic for today is the incomparable Abraham Ibn Ezra, who was a phenomenal individual with tremendously complex life, a life of great sadness and tribulation, and a life of genius and exceptional achievement in Torah scholarship in particular. I think one of the most fascinating things that I take away from his life is the fact that Ibn Ezra that we primarily know as Jews, and we are the people who study him most of all the various fields of inquiry that he inspired, from poetry to astronomy to mathematics to linguistics, he really only began his career as a Torah scholar, as a publishing Torah scholar, when he was about my age, when he was in his 50s and he was exiled from the Iberian Peninsula. At that point, he had to change careers quite late in life, and it was only then that he really explored his genius. As we discussed a few weeks ago, when we were looking at Sadia Gaon, he had to get fired from his job as the Gaon of Sura in order to start writing, and ultimately it was his writing that made the greatest contribution in life. I'm reminded as well of a role model in my own life, Rabbi Dr. Lander Zatzal, who only started Touro College when he was 54 years old, and it's become such a massive enterprise, and it's affected the lives of so many tens of thousands of people. There are these people like that, Ibn Ezra's, who are able to change their lives midstream when other people are sort of looking down towards moving down to Boca or something like that. They're thinking about, what else can I achieve? And Ibn Ezra is such a person. He lived a life of tremendous penury, and he complained about it with some eloquence. I'll share with you, for example, one poem that he wrote. These are translated from the original Judeo-Arabic. Unfortunately, I forgot the name of the translator in the other. I'll write it when I put this on the web, the exact translator. But he writes a poem called My Stars. On the day I was born, the unalterable stars altered. If I decided to sell lamps, it wouldn't get dark till the day I died. Some stars, whatever I do, I'm a failure before I begin. If I suddenly decided to sell shrouds, people would suddenly stop dying. Right? So he definitely had a very kind of pessimistic, dark view of the universe that seems to pervade much of his writings, although not universally. We'll see how that is. Now, what was he doing for a living? What was so difficult about his life? He was what we would call in Yiddish, in many ways, a Luftmensch, a man who lived on air. And this is a term that really is better applied to 19th century Eastern Europe. And it refers to people who somehow eke out a living without any clear sense of what their revenue stream really is. In medieval Spain, in the golden period when he lived, he was a professional poet. And he would, you know, compose works of poetry, which was hugely in demand in Spanish culture, Arabic Spanish culture. He would compose, you know, what they would call a boast poetry, in which people would compose, you know, these poems that celebrated their business acumen or their military strengths or, you know, various achievements in their life. He would compose curse poetry that was used as an imprecation against people you didn't like, and this was like a business. This was kind of like graphic designers for the internet today. He was a poet for hire who'd do these things. But it's a difficult job to have, because once you write the poem, it's over. You know, you get paid once, and then you've got to write another poem. You can't use the same poem again, because they were in circulation. It was part of the culture to repeat poetry. We happen to live, it's sad, in America in the early 21st century. We live in a very poetry debased society. We have very little poetry in circulation. I spent some time with Boaz, my son, who was not here, by the way. I'll really have to give it to him. He and I just spent some time studying The Second Coming by Yeats, and it was fascinating to actually walk a young mind through the meaning of that poem. But we are bereft of these things. I'm sorry for going on like that. Anyways, he eked out a career as a professional poet, and he was essentially going from wealthy person to try and flog his wares, and he would make a sale every now and then. Here's one of his poems in which he describes what it's like. This is called The Patron, which is referring, of course, to his supporters. When I come to the patron's house early in the morning, they say, he has already ridden away. When I come in the evening, they say, he has already gone to sleep. He either climbs into his carriage or climbs into his bed. Woe to the poor man, woe to misfortune. Right? So we get the sense that for most of his early adulthood and his middle age, he was a person who just managed to live on the sidelines. Definitely a huge Talmud Chacham, definitely someone who was very conversant with Torah scholarship, but not publishing. He didn't have the personality really to be a community rabbi. He was kind of irascible and difficult and sometimes a little bit pugilistic. These are not characteristics that we admire in community rabbis in general. We want them to, you know, find ways to make pshara and shalom, and he was not that kind of a person. And so this was his life. For reasons that are not entirely clear, he ended up fleeing the Iberian Peninsula when he was about 50, perhaps exiled. He was very well connected. In fact, he was married into the family of Yehuda HaLevi, but his son Isaac apparently moved out to the Middle East and converted to Islam, which was a huge shock for him. There's some debate over exactly what happened. It's possible that Ibn Ezra even sat Shiva for his son, although the dates and the documents that support this are still under dispute. At any rate, possibly the reason why he left, we don't exactly know, was the expansion of the Almohads. It's a very extreme form of Islam that chose to move away from the traditional tolerance of Dhimmi, of Jews and Christians as people of the book, towards a more intolerant and demanding form of Islam that would not brook the presence of non-believers in their midst. Maimonides, of course, would also flee the Almohads and make his way across the coast of North Africa to Egypt. In the case of the Ibn Ezra, he would actually make quite a tour of the Mediterranean basin, all across the coast of North Africa, into the Italian peninsula, and well into continental Europe, trying to put together a livelihood living in great straits. During this time, it became clear, this is his period of wandering and also his period of greatest creativity, he found that he could no longer make a living as a Judeo-Arabic poet in Christian Europe. You know, surprising, right? Because they're not speaking Arabic, and the culture of Christian Europe does not have the same respect and admiration for poetry that the Muslims did, and so he had to switch careers. He could not be a pulpit rabbi. He could not be much of a teacher. He didn't have that kind of patience in his personality, so he took to scholarship. And he would sell his writings. Quite often, he was so broke, he actually had to sell his original manuscripts. That's why we actually have multiple copies of many of his works, because he would sell it, the original. He had no more money even to buy more writing instruments, and then he would have to write it again from memory. And so the second version usually tended to be quite a bit bigger and quite a bit more expansive. But this is the kind of living on the edge that he enjoyed during the periods of his greatest creativity. And this is when he really came into his own as a Hebrew scholar, as he wrote his greatest works on astronomy, on grammar, and of course in Torah scholarship, which Rabbi Teitelbaum is going to speak of in quite a bit more detail. I'm not going to go into it in much discussion here at all, but I will say that the Ibn Ezra's commentary on the Torah is uniquely fascinating, and it provides tremendous grounds for future exploration by scholars like Spinoza and eventually the 19th century biblical critic Wellhausen, who saw in his rationalist approach to the Torah the possibility of much larger ideas that were definitely contrarian to the Orthodox point of view. In fact, the Ibn Ezra's point of view is pretty much the maximum extreme you can go and still remain B'toch ha-machane, you know, inside the camp ideologically, as we shall see in the second half of this hour. He has a big problem with Midrash. He tries very hard not to rely on Midrash as a source for biblical commentary. This puts him at tremendous odds with figures like Rashi, of course, figures like the Ramban, who we spoke about early in the series. And it's a unique approach to Torah that is really unparalleled by anyone in his generation. Halacha, nevertheless, let us not mistake the fact that he remained a very much an observant Jew, very much adherent to Halacha, and was often engaged in heavy polemics with anyone who would impugn the value of Halacha. He had significant arguments with the Karaites, a movement that started a few centuries earlier that argued that the oral Torah was a human rabbinic invention and it was not actually divine in origin. But his approach against the Karaites and his rationalist arguments proved to be extremely useful to Ramban later when he had the dispute that we discussed earlier in this class, because these rationalist arguments could communicate across cultures and could be used in a disputation with the church. So his approach to these things was exceptionally significant. So to try and wrap up and give you a sense of his life as a whole, and also to give plenty of room for the in-depth text that we will be studying shortly, we should understand him as essentially a poet who had to make a major transition from that way of life to becoming a scholar. Without having an official position of any kind, he was forced to eke out a living as an independent scholar, composing treatises which he would later sell, often right down to the original copies, but nevertheless he gained quite a bit of wide circulation with these things. He was canonized as a commentator. We have him on the page of the Mikraos Gedolos, but his opinions nevertheless are quite a bit on the extreme of the Orthodox spectrum. His extremist opinions had a tremendous impact on later thinkers. His thought actually crossed over into the Christian world as well. His poetry was translated into Latin, other languages, such that even in the 19th and 20th century you see examples of his work. Robert Browning wrote a poem which cites a Rabbi Ezra, referring to Ibn Ezra. Of course, Ibn means son of, and so it's not quite correct to call him Rabbi Ezra because he is Abraham, son of Ezra. But Browning wrote a beautiful poem, Grow Old With Me, which is an ode of homage to the great biblical commentator. And in fact, even John Lennon in our own times wrote a song that was based on Browning's poem, which later goes back to the Ibn Ezra. His work in astrology, which I can't possibly comment on with anything intelligent, was nevertheless recognized by scholars of that field as being something quite significant. And if you look over here, there's actually a crater on the moon. Next time you look at the moon, just pay attention to this little red spot here. You can notice it if you look very carefully. You'll see there's a red circle around it. And this is called the Ibn Ezra crater. Here's a close-up of it that is specifically named after this 12th century scholar in recognition of his tremendous achievements in the field. Okay, so I've compressed my remarks because I think it's really important that we study the text. We have a lot of great text to come, and I'm going to turn it over at this point to Rabbi Teitelbaum.
To look at Ibn Ezra's magnum opus, which is his Parish on the Torah, which is known as the Sefer HaYashar. We call it, of course, more commonly the Ibn Ezra. And you can see just from his opening remarks how proud he is of the work. On the one hand, you also begin to sense how facile he is in the language, in Lashon HaKodesh. He says here, Sefer HaYashar LaAvraham Hashar, to Avraham the poet, Uba'avosos HaDiktuk Nikshar. He says that all of my writing, all of what I will be presenting, will be bound by ropes of grammar. So from the onset, he is making it clear that he is going to be a literalist, if you will. Ube'enei hadas yichshar. Those with intelligence will see that this is really the right way to address the Torah and to comment on the Torah. They will see fit to follow in my footsteps. V'chol tomcho mu'ushar, those who take this, and maybe he is saying those who support this kind of work, he always was lacking in the kind of support he would have liked, they will be very, very fortunate. We are going to continue to look at his hakdama. What he does is introduce his parish by first describing so many of the other paths that he says are incorrect, describing the paths that he will eschew, that he says these are not the ways of proper parish on the Torah. And the first that he says is not quite what we should be following is the path of, let us call it, lengthy exposition. By the way, all of his akdama is written in poetic rhyme. Beautiful, beautiful Ivrit, or Lashon HaKodesh. He says that it is very long and long-winded, and most people can appreciate it and gain from it. He says, "V'im ha'emes nekuda or kinekuda b'toch ha'agula," if truth, and what we're trying to arrive at, is that bullseye, that point at the very center, "Zos ha'derech kikav ha'rochav hu ha'chut ha'sovev b'tchila," then going into expansive, long, lengthy dissertations on Torah, that's like maybe getting at that circle surrounding the bullseye, but you're never really reaching your target. And then he goes on to say, for instance, he talks about Rabbeinu Yitzchak HaYisraeli and some of what he wrote. He writes how Chiber Shnei Svarim Mibreishis Ad VaYechulu VaOd Lo Kala Meirov Dvarim. In other words, he wrote treatises and barely got through much of the Torah at all. He then criticizes Rabbeinu Sadjigon. Ubemesila Hazos Ola Rav Sadjigon Hagola. So he obviously has great respect for Rav Sadjigon, but he says Rav Sadjigon also in his parish follows this long style, long-winded style, without really explaining the pasuk, its true meaning, its basic meaning. He gives an example of Perish Yehi Ma'oros, Hichnis Deos Acheros, Ladas Hamidos Haniskaros. He talks there about all kinds of issues, about the celestial bodies, things that are not pertinent to the explanation of the pasuk itself. Here, from Bereshis, Perik Beis, Pasuk Yud Aleph, where the Torah describes the great rivers, Shema Echot Pishon, Hi Asoveves, Kol Eretz Achavila. So Rabbeinu Sadjigon identifies this river as the Nile. And how do you know it's the Nile, asks Ibn Ezra. He suggests, Ulai b'chalom ra'am. Perhaps Ibn Sadjigon saw it in a dream. Ukvarta b'miktsasam ka'asher afarej b'mekomo. There are all kinds of mistakes that have been made. Imkein lo nishan al chalomosav. We will not rely on things that he dreamt up, but he does defend Rabbi Sadjigon and says, look, he had to say something. Ulai asokein l'chvod Hashem b'avur shetirgim ha'torah b'loshin Yishmael. It's being translated, after all, by Rabbi Sadjigon into Arabic, and with their alphabets. Therefore, he needed to say something, and he needed to give some explanation so that otherwise people are going to say, what's he hiding? Or is this not a really true reflection of what is in the Bible? The fact is that Ibn Ezra, importantly, is the first great Spanish commentator on Torah, where there had been none in Hebrew. What had preceded his work all had been indeed in Arabic in that part of the world. Another example, however, of his beautiful writing, his scientific ability to mix astronomy, astrology, and Torah. It's long-winded, though. He was allowed, I guess. He permitted himself that. And that is that in Parshas Yisro, he actually shows how each of the Aseres HaDibros connects to a specific constellation. And as you get closer and closer to the more basic and human kinds of issues of Lo Sirtzach, Lo Sinaf, and finally Lo Sachmod, they are the lowest constellations, and he explains this all very beautifully, but of course it's a philosophical approach, and it's more of the long-winded approach than the literalist approach. Then again, he wrote a Be'er HaKotzer, he had a shortened version originally, and only wrote the more expanded version of his parish. The one we have is on Shmos, most of the rest of it has been lost. Now, the next path that he says we should not follow, the second of the four paths that he negates, the path of the Karoim. As we heard before, the Karaites deny that there is a Torah Shebaal Peh. It's a rabbinic contravention. He calls it Derech Psaltolim. Haderech Hashaniya, the second path. Bachrua Psaltolim, those crooked people, Imhem Yisraelim, if Jews take that path, Ashachoshu ki amdu al hanakuda b'atzma, if they think they're getting to the truth, Vehem lo yodu esmakoma, they don't even know where to look. And then he talks about Anon, the founder of the Karaites, Binyamin ben Mashiach, Yeshua, Vehem kol min asher b'divrei matik ados lo yamin, they don't believe in the works of the great Chachamim. They don't believe in Torah Shebaal Peh, so therefore they end up erring to the left, to the right. Everybody says whatever they'd like about how to understand the pasuk. Gam b'mitzvos u'b'chukim, v'heim midas totzos loshon hakodesh reikim, and they don't even know Hebrew. So here you see him really saying how important it is to have a real good grounding in Ivris, in Lashon HaKodesh, in Hebrew grammar. Otherwise, you can't possibly come to understand the Torah. But you also see here how he completely and utterly rejects those who would say that, no, we have to just study Torah Shebichsav, and Torah Shebaal Peh is not something that's divinely ordained. You here see that he was an absolutely believing Jew in every way. Torah Shebichsav, Torah Shebaal Peh. Some of the examples in which he says something almost critically, really, it's more than jocular, he is actually ribbing the Karaites. The pasuk says in Bereshis Chavtes, Ve'enei Leah Rakos, Leah's eyes were somehow watery, she was tearing up constantly because the Medrash says she was destined, she thought, to be married to Esav. So here, he quotes Ben Ephraim. Ben Ephraim is a character. Ben Ephraim Omar Shehu Chaser Aleph, Rakos is mixing an Aleph. It should be Aruchos, Tamo Aruchos. She had long, narrow eyes, and that was the problem. And Ibn Ezra says he's wrong. Vahu Haya Chaser Aleph. It is he, Ephraim, who's missing the Aleph. So instead of Ben Ephraim, his name is Ben Parim, an ox. Let's go to another example of that kind of, let us call it his rejection, if you will, of the Karaites. You know, the Torah says that in Mitzrayim, that the Jewish people were to eat because they had to leave b'chipazon. They should be dressed and ready to leave Eretz Mitzrayim. So he says, it seems to be a city in Algeria, in Argalon. They eat their Seder dressed that way, ready to go. They're all mistaken. And he says, "Kulam yelchu yom chamisha asam ha'artzim zeichel yitzias Mitzrayim." When Pesach comes, let them go. Let them leave. Let them go into exile. And finally, another example, where in Parshas Mishpatim, you have the famous psukim of Kiigov Shar Ish Es Shar Ehu. And it's about one ox goring another ox. The ox of one Jew gores the ox of a second Jew. And he says, Ben Zuta actually interpreted or misinterpreted this to mean that the ox gores its fellow ox, when actually, correctly, it means that the ox of one Jew gored the ox of a fellow Jew. So he says, Amar ben Zuta ki re'ehu tohar l'shar. V'loi ra'a, he didn't realize, ki shor ish samachu, it's the shor of a man, and so too, shor re'ehu, the ox of his fellow man, ve'ein l'shor re'a ben zuta levado. You know, oxen have no good friends, except for ben zuta, he's... Okay, so we have another path, a path of mysticism and a path of, let us call it, obscurity, where that which we don't understand in Torah is hidden and meant to be hidden. And most of Torah, therefore, is allegory. And he says, no, that's not our job. HaKadosh Baruch Hu gave us the Torah. God gave us the Torah to understand, to live by. And you can only live by it if we first understand it correctly. By and by, however, in this piece, when he talks about this derech choshech va'afela, he said it's entirely mechutz l'kav ha'gula. It's outside that circle entirely, let alone you're not getting to the bullseye. You're outside the circle entirely, he says, hem ha'bodim libam l'chol advarim sodos v'munosim ki ataros v'hamishpatim chidos. They think it's all, you know, some kind of a riddle and some kind of a parable or allegory. V'lo arich l'hashiv aleihem. I'm not even going to go into much length as to rebut any of what they claim, but what he does say, importantly, is bilti bedavar echad tzadku. There is one thing that they are right about. Asher kol davar mitzvah ketana ogdola. Every mitzvah, every precept of the Torah, bekaf ma'ozne halev tihyashkula. We have to apply our hearts and minds. Ki yesh belev dea mechachmas yoshev kedem netua. Netua, that it is in our hearts with God's wisdom implanted in us that we are to study the Torah. It's a fascinating concept. We are able to come to the truth of Torah because we are Hashem's people and He has planted within us the ability to understand the Torah. Therefore, since He has given us that God-given gift, let's use it. Let's study. Let's mine the treasures that are contained within the Torah. And if we come upon psukim that we can't understand, he says, then maybe we have to say, well, it's mystical. Az yivakesh sod. But otherwise, he says before that, vim hadas lo tisbol hadavar. If we can't logically understand it, then we have to reject that which is illogical or that which is implausible. And then there are some obviously famous cases in which Ibn Ezra says that we have to make sure to read the Torah literally, understand what happened, for instance, at the Akedah, and not necessarily accept every opinion midrashically offered. And we'll get into why and how we can look away from some of the Midrashim according to Ibn Ezra. But before we get into that, let's just look at this example. We have Yitzchak at the Akedah. How old is Yitzchak at the Akedah? Chachameinu tell us, he quotes, Yitzchak at the Akedah was ben 37 shanim. He was 37 years old. He says, look, im divrei kabbalah nikabel. I readily accept it if that is a tradition from Sinai, generation after generation, fine. But he says, Miderach Svara Ein Zenachon. Because if he's 37 years old, Shehaya Ro'i Shetia Tzitkas Yitzchak Galuya, then the whole celebration of the courage and the devotion of Avraham Avinu should be actually the courage and celebration of what Yitzchak was ready to do at the Akedah. It should be all about Yitzchak and Yitzchak's courage and not Avraham Avinu's courage. Acherim Amru Shehaya Ben Chameshonim, Gamzeh Lo Yitochen. Can't be he was 5 years old, because it says in the Torah, Bavur Shanosa Atzeh Ha'ola. The Torah says that it was Yitzchak who carried all the wood. If he's 4 or 5 years old, how could he have carried the wood? So this is all a very logical approach through which he says it must be that ultimately he was Karov Liyud Gimel Shanim. That's a heck of a way to prepare for your bar mitzvah, to go to the Akedah. But he was young enough and innocent enough to therefore follow, strong enough to carry the wood, but not old enough to be given all of the credit for that kind of self-sacrifice. Another example, famously, and Rashi quotes this medrash, Atzei Shittim, the great wood used for the crushing of the Mishkan. Yaakov Avinu planted them in Mitzrayim, Chachameinu tell us, and told us, when you leave Mitzrayim, you'll need these for the construction of the Mishkan. Take them with you. And the Ibn Ezra asks, but how could the Mitzrayim let them go, ostensibly to worship their God for 3 days? Why are they taking all this lumber with them? As an example of how rationally, you know, the Ibn Ezra says, it just doesn't really make sense. He says, perhaps there was some kind of a ya'ar, some forest, some area near Har Sinai, where when they arrived, they were able to cut these trees, and that's how they had the kerushim, the great wood beams that comprised the walls of the Mishkan. The fourth path that Ibn Ezra says we should reject is the path of homiletics, of drash. And he says, with a very organized pattern in it all, he says, Krovel Nakuda, it's close to the truth. Rotva Chareha Aguda, everybody runs after Medrash. We all enjoy it, we all learn it and study it. He says, Zos Derech HaChachamim Ba'artzos Yevonim Vadomim. From Greece and Rome, it's been a tradition, Shaliyabitu El Mishkal Maznaim, that they don't use their heads, they don't think and weigh the relative value and meaning of the truth of the Psukim. Rak Yismocho or Yismocho Al Derech Drash Kelekach Tov Arinayim. Hamidrashim. Number one, once you have these midrashim in Sifri HaKadmonim, lama yagi'unu l'kosvam shenis eloh achronim, why repeat it? If you have it in Medrash, leave it there. If you're going to write a commentary on the Torah, don't just repeat what the Medrash says. That's number one. V'yesh drash hefech drash. He says, secondly, you have so many contradicting midrashim. If you're going to use Medrash to arrive at the truth, well then, what's the truth? When one Medrash says one thing, and another Medrash says another. And finally he says, V'yesh lo sod v'einonu mefurush. And so much of it is so hard to understand. It's mystical anyway. He uses an example, the famous case, the drasha, Torah kadma alpayim shana kadma olam. Torah existed 2,000 years before the world. If there's no world, then there's no physical matter. If no physical matter, so then there's no time-space relationship. How can there be time? How can you say 2,000 years if there was no universe, if there's no physical world? He asks. That's just one example. He goes on to give a number of examples. And of course, this was something that, let's just say, it stirred up the ire of some of the commentators. Here you have a Tiferes Yisrael of the Maharal, where he quotes how Ibn Ezra criticized the famous drash about why the Torah begins with a beis, bereshis, because beis is the letter of bracha. And it's an important idea, and we accept it, of course, as true. And Ibn Ezra says, no, beis, beis can stand for all kinds of things. And he gives lists and lists of words that are of a negative nature that begin with a beis. Bitlu hatochenos, Koheles says, you'll come to your old age and your teeth don't work anymore. So it's with a beis, bitlu Hatochanos. Does that mean that Beis is such a beautiful, wonderful letter? Baal Yida'um. Baal Yida'um means that nations of the world, people don't know, don't understand. They are bereft. So the Beis isn't such a wonderful letter, is it? Says the Maharal Lubavadai, Harav Ibn Ezra, Baal Yida'um. He says, the one who didn't know was the Ibn Ezra. Baal Yida'um Divrei Chachamim HaNe'emanim. He says, because ki Divreihem Heim Emes B'Chachma. Hu Lo Haven. He did not understand Divrei Chachamim. So there's tremendous criticism that he, the Ibn Ezra, invited by being so adamant about not following Drash, not getting involved in it, not basing our religious life, and not getting so involved with it, not just in commentary, but in philosophically guiding our lives based on so much drash. He, Ibn Ezra, was not one to really feel that's the way we have to build and construct our culture, our religion. Pru Revu, we take it that the Torah says that it is a mitzvah. In the minyan mitzvos, that's another area, by the way, he did not say that we are bound to believe that there are exactly 613 mitzvos. He says that Pru Revu is actually just a blessing. Umilas pirdi v'rivya ba'adam brachahi. Kemo bibriyas hamayim. Rak hi mitzvah he'etikuha kadmonenu. Zichronum levracha. Rather, it is written as a mitzvah by our rabbis. V'samu zeha pasuk zecher ladover. This is a typical Ibn Ezra in that he says, look, the literal interpretation of the pasuk is not, we have a commandment, be fruitful and multiply, have children, but it is a mitzvah. If rabbis in the Talmud say it's a mitzvah, then it's a mitzvah. But they have that by tradition. It's not because the Torah literally said so. Another example, the rehabilitation of Nimrod. What kind of a person was Nimrod? Oh, he was a very, very negative person. He used his powers to threaten mankind, not just Avram Avinu, but, you know, it was Amraphel. He is Nimrod, and he was Hechelios Gibor Ba'aretz. As Rashi says, he was doing whatever he could with his Gevura rebelliously against the will of God. Well, according to Ibn Ezra, he says, Hechel laharos gvuros bni adam alachayos, ki haya gibor tzayid. He was a tremendous hunter. V'tam lefnei Hashem doesn't mean against God. It doesn't mean that he would say, I'm powerful, God is powerful, maybe I'm more powerful, as you might wish to interpret it. He says, Shehaya bonem mizbechos umale osam hachayos olol Hashem. Nimrod captured animals and brought them on the Mizbeach. He offered them up to God. That's the truth of what the Torah is saying to us about Nimrod. V'hadrash derech acheres. The drash, that's a different path altogether. So that's a bit startling. Most of us are familiar with these interpretations as taught to us by Rashi. There is a very important mention of Rashi in the Ibn Ezra's Safa Baruta, which is really a grammatical work, where he says, Ein mikra yotze midei pshuto v'hadrash hu tosefes ta'am. It is just an added flavor, an added sense of what the Torah might be telling us. V'hadoros haboim, the generations that followed, somu called drash ikar v'shorish. They've made so much out of drash. Kireb Shlomo Zal, like Rashi, shepiresh tenach al derech drash. He, Rashi, comments on all of the Torah, neviim ksuvim, homiletically, and he says, v'hu choshev. He thinks, ki hu al derech pshat. He thinks he's writing pshat. And then he says, v'ein, Bisvarov Pshat Rak echad minei aleph. Really? Pshat in Rashi? It's all drash. One in a thousand. That's a bit of an exaggeration, but he's really clearly adamant about what kind of parish we should or shouldn't use as we study Torah. He says Pshat and Rashi is one in a thousand. So what he does say is the right path is the path of the Hebrew grammarian and literalism. Haderach HaChamishis Musad Perushi Aleha Ashis. I'm basing and founding my commentary, V'hiha Yeshara Be'enai. It's what I think is proper. Nochach Pnei Hashem, Asher Mimenu Levado Ira. I only fear God. V'lo Es Eponim Batorah, V'achapes Heitev Dikduk Kol Mila B'chol Me'odi. I will look for the meaning, the true meaning, of each and every word in the Torah. I will then explain it as best I can. He says, wherever you find the word for the first time in Tanakh, that's its anchor. That's its basis. You shall extrapolate from there what it means and how it's applied elsewhere in Tanakh. So here we see in these first few lines how much he wants to tell us to emphasize study, literalism, studying the language, appreciating Hebrew diktuk. He says, as far as other interpretations, that he talks about, you know, where you have a word that's malay, a word that's chaser, it's with a vav, it's without a vav. He says, rak litinokos ta'amehem tovim heim. For young children, that's the kind of Torah that you may want to teach. But as adults, really, we have to know the truth of Torah. We have to study it very carefully and with a great deal of emphasis on what he would say is literal understanding. Let's see where his literalism sometimes, however, led him. Goat's meat and milk. It says it three times in the Torah. Rashi explains how gdi means a young animal, be it a goat or otherwise. Says the Ibn Ezra, no, a gdi is a goat, period. Rabbi Shlomo Amar, ki a gdi hu hakatan harach. But Ibn Ezra says, no. Gdi gadol migdi izim. That's why sometimes it's called gdi, sometimes it's called gdi izim. Not that there's another kind of gdi. A gdi always means a goat. He explains, therefore, that the Torah actually never talks about meat and milk if it's not goat meat. But chachamim kiblu, there's a tradition from the time Torah was given. Torah shebal peh, shelo yochal Yisrael basar b'chalav. But it's not something found verbatim in the Torah. Here he really says something that halachically is difficult to answer. It's basically unfounded, where he says that chalev, the parts of the fat of an animal that's otherwise kosher, that there are cuts of chalev that we are not allowed to eat. He says that's only if it's a korban. If that animal was a korban, then the chalev is not allowed to be eaten. And here, we have a real difficulty. We know that Chachamenu said chalev is prohibited, period. But he says, and here are his words, haraya, the proof is, raya gemura, sha'amar b'sefer eile hadvarim, b'basar taiva, shehu chol, where it's not a korban, sheyochlenu kulo. It seems to say in Devarim you can eat all of it. V'lo hotzi rak es damo levado b'shlosha mekamos. Only the blood may not be eaten, but the chalev seems to be permissible. It is this kind of commentary that the Yom Shel Shlomo, the great Rav Shlomo Luria of 16th century Lublin, says you just have to reject the Ibn Ezra and cannot live Jewish life based on what the Ibn Ezra says. We certainly will not follow his halachic guidelines. He says that although the Rambam, in a letter which might be attributed to the Rambam, seems to tell his son to study Ibn Ezra, Rav Shlomo Luria says, Ashalo haya bal Talmud, again, Rabbi Avram Ibn Ezra, Asher, lo haya bal Talmud, v'rov binyano uperusho al derech hatchuna v'hativim. It's all about astronomy, physics, science, v'kabbalas chitzoni yusa. Tris bekama mekomos keneged divrei chachmei haTorah v'haTalmud. Therefore, umashahu min haTorah kosav shehu midrabanan. There are things that are midaraisa, which Ibn Ezra mistakenly says are rabbinic. Umashahu amad rabanan asahu ledivrei Torah, v'haoser asahu heter, v'heter asahu iser. So he has tremendous, tremendous problems with Ibn Ezra. He was not alone, but he was very vociferous. This is in his introduction to his Yamshel Shlomo on Maseches Kulin. A final example of this literalism, and one that's a bit shocking. Vayishkav es Bilha Pilagesh Aviv Vayishma Yisrael Reuven, the Torah says, literally slept with Bilha, one of his father's wives. And of course, we understand it to have been as heinous a crime as that, but it was that he had moved the bed of Yaakov out from where he had gone to Bilha, Rachel's Pilagesh. He wanted jealously, Reuven, that his mother, Leah, should now be the preferred loved wife of Yaakov. In his commentary, Ibn Ezra says as follows. Yafe pirishu rabbeisenu zichronam livracha. They commented and they did a beautiful job on explaining or in explaining what it is that happened. V'chosa klon arum, quoting from Mishle, one who covers shame is clever. Meaning that what happened actually was quite shameful, and Chachameinu are covering that shame. In his Yesod Mora, where in his philosophical work, Yesod Mora, which is a very important work and deserves shiurim unto itself, here, when describing the greatness of Yaakov Avinu, he says, Ki kasher ba el beisel omar hasiru es elehe anechar, he left his flocks, his bodeid lavod Hashem. He became the holiest that Yaakov ever became upon his return to Eretz Yisrael. V'loi shachav im isha, he no longer had any more children, lived with no one of his wives, ki Rachel Mesa, v'chulala Bilha. And Bilha had been violated. U'bavur zeh, therefore, the Torah says, Al Kain Ksiv, in the next pasuk, Vayihiyu bnei Yaakov shneim asar lohodia shle shachavim isha acher kach al kain lo hoylid oid. The Torah's point is that he really had been with Bilha. After that, Yaakov said, I will not be with Leah's concubine, not with Leah either, not with Bilha, because she has been violated. And so he has 12 sons and no more. That's the Ibn Ezra's literalist approach to those psukim. The Ibn Ezra's legacy, as we heard earlier, includes how some have tried to, if you will, adopt Ibn Ezra to their cause. Most infamously, Baruch Spinoza, the great 17th century rationalist, claimed that the Torah was not of divine origin and claimed that Ibn Ezra had said as much. Shmuel David Lutzato, Shadal, defends Ibn Ezra, does a beautiful job pointing out that it is not true. Ki lo Moshe kasav sefer haTorah. Hine emes ki Rabbi Avraham ben Ezra ramaz derech sod. He mentions in a very oblique way. Ki yesh b'Torah k'tzas mikraos nosafim achrei mos Moshe. Yes, he says that perhaps certain psukim, v'haknani oz ba'aretz, the describing of the bed that Og Melech HaBashan had and where it can still be seen on display. Perhaps there were psukim added, perhaps, the Ibn Ezra said. But otherwise, the fact that he adds to the last eight psukim of the Torah, where Rabbi Huda or Rabbi Nechemya say that it was written by Yehoshua, Ibn Ezra says it's 12 psukim instead of 8 psukim, says Shadal, this is all not in any way to say that the Torah is not of divine origin. He says, Im haya b'libo shesefer ha-Torah lo Moshe kasvo lo chaser tachbulos haya Ibn Ezra lirmoz machshavto kimo shehi. And so he says, chalila chalila, to say that Ibn Ezra can be used to support the likes of heretical Baruch Spinoza. And that's a very important point, because what he did that way, Shadal, was make it clear that with all of the controversy surrounding, swirling about Ibn Ezra's literalism, he was a God-fearing, faithful Jew with complete and abiding respect of Chachameinu and of Torah Shebaal Peh. Yes, it was a nuanced view in which he would say, look, there is Midrashei Agada, which we do not have to take at face value, and there are Midrashei Halacha, which we will always take literally and follow completely, because that's what HaKadosh Baruch Hu expects of us. And finally, I just want to point out that another great expression of how Ibn Ezra, say what you will about him, is a force to reckon with. We've been studying the Hakdama of Ibn Ezra's commentary. Let's look at the Hakdama of Nachmanides, of Ramban's commentary, where he's praising Rashi. He calls him Lo Mishpat HaBachora, B'dvar Vehege B'Havasam Eshge, etc., etc. He does not discount Ibn Ezra, though. He says, V'im Rabbi Avraham ben Ezra tihyalanu tochachas megula. We will openly disagree, and even vehemently so. V'ahava misutares, or misutara. But we will also keep love, if not necessarily always expressed, but we harbor a great love and appreciation for what Ibn Ezra has done and what he leaves us in his masterful commentary, having us understand Torah and its language with so much more depth, with so much more clarity, that is the legacy then of Rabbi Avraham Ibn Ezra.